गुड मॉर्निंग स्टूडेंट्स, गुड मॉर्निंग टू ऑल। सो वेलकम बैक टू ओएस क्लासेस। सो इन लास्ट सेशन वी वाज डिस्कस्ड अबाउट प्रोसेस कॉन्सेप्ट। सो इन टुडे सेशन वी आर गोइंग टू डिस्कसिंग अबाउट प्रोसेस शेड्यूलिंग। सो हियर फर्स्ट ऑफ ऑल व्हाई वी आर यूजिंग प्रोसेस शेड्यूलिंग और व्हाट इज मीन बाय प्रोसेस शेड्यूलिंग। सो हियर टू मैक्सिमाइज द सीपीयू यूसेज एंड क्विकली स्विचिंग द प्रोसेसेस ऑन टू CPU for the purpose of time sharing. So for that purpose we are using the process scheduling. So that means to maximizing the utilization of the CPU time and to immediately switching, that means quickly switching from one process execution to another process execution in time sharing manner. So for that purpose we are using the CPU scheduling or process scheduling. So here to schedule the process, for that purpose we are using the one scheduler. So that is called process scheduler. So this process scheduler is responsible for select available processes from various processes. So that means here there are some number of processes are ready for executing, are ready for executing their processes. So in this process, this process scheduler is responsible for choose any one process from those among any one process among several ready processes to execute. So in these processes it will choose any specific process for next instruction or for next execution on the CPU. So for that purpose we are using the process scheduler. So this process scheduler maintains some scheduling queue, some scheduling queue of process. That means it was maintaining some number of processes information to executing the that such particular processes. So these all processes are wait in some queue manner. So that means first in first out manner. So in this process we are using several sub terminologies, several terminologies. Those are job queue. So this job queue is responsible or contains the information about all processes in the system, whatever the total number of processes currently running on, currently using on the system. So those all processes information was available in the job queue. And next, ready queue. So from job queue, in job queue it was having total number of processes in that system. Ready queue, so it contains from all or from set of all processes which processes are currently ready for executing, currently ready for executing. So to execute such processes, so those are currently available in main memory, and such kind of information was maintained by the ready queue. So here job queue maintains all processes information, and ready queue means from all processes which process was copied in the main memory and currently waiting for the execution or currently are ready for the execution. So such information maintained by the ready queue. And one more is device queue. So this device queue can maintain set of processes waiting for an IO device. So that means from all processes which process was currently are waiting for the IO devices IO devices allocation. So such information was maintained in the device queues. So in this process, processes can migrate among the various queues. So these are the several queues are used to scheduling the process. So initially we are using the process scheduler. This responsibility is, such responsibility is schedule pick up next instruction or next process to executed by the CPU. So from among all processes it will pick up which process can execute next. That is the responsibility of process scheduler. And next we are using the several scheduling queues. Those are job queue, ready queue, device queue, these queues. So in this job queue is maintains which type of information, means it maintains the total number of processes in that system. And ready queue maintains from total number of processes which processes was ready for execution. And device queue means from total number of processes which processes was waiting for the IO allocation. So these are the several queues are maintained by the process scheduler. So here we can observe whatever the several queues are used in the process scheduling. So this is the queue header, and this is the ready queue, And in this and next, this is the magnetic tape unit 0, magnetic tape unit 1, disk unit 0, terminal unit 0. So and so on, some number of devices was used in the CPU. And here, coming to the first one, ready queue. So it contains which type of information from all processes, which process was ready for executing. So for example, process control block 7 and process control block 2. So these two are currently ready for execution. So that's why those two information was maintained in the ready queue header. So in this queue headers, it was contains the two parts. One is the header and another one is the tail. So in this header indicates the starting location of the ready process, and the tailor indicates the ending process location. So here we are using one more memory unit, that is the disk unit 0. So here also it maintains whatever the processes was available in the particular CPU for execution. So this head contains the starting process control blocks, and this tail contains the ending control block. So here total three processes was ready for execution. So that's why so these three information was maintained in the disk unit 0. So once these processes was copied into the main memory, then it will go to the ready queue. So and then it was sending the one by one instruction for CPU scheduling or for CPU execution. So this is the process. So this is the ready queue and various IO devices queues in the CPU. So in this process, how we are representing the one some process execution or some process scheduling. So for that purpose, we are using the queuing diagram. So this queuing diagram can represent whatever the queues and whatever the resources and what is the flow of execution. So in this diagram, we can observe, for example, there is some process was ready for execution. In this process, how it was maintains the several queues and their transitions, that means one queue to another queue, how control was moving. So that such kind of information was provided by the representation of the process scheduling. So for example, this is the ready queue. So ready queue means it contains which type of information. So from all processes, which process was ready for execution. So that information was maintained in the ready queue. So in case there was some processes ready for execution, then it was sending such process to the CPU for running the execution. So in this CPU was to execute that particular instruction or to execute that particular process, it must require some IO information, some input or output information. So for that purpose, it was sending the request to the IO. So now that request was forwarded to the IO queue. So this IO queue was sending such particular information to the IO device. So now this IO device was again send such information to the ready queue. So whenever this IO device information is available, then CPU was executing that particular process. So in case here, CPU was waiting for the IO device or IO request. So within that, in case time was expired, again go to the ready queue and again scheduling from the beginning of that particular process. So in case this particular CPU was waiting for the creation of the new process for execution. So at that situation, we are using the new process creation. For that purpose, we are using some system call or from function. Some function, that is a fork function. So this fork function is used to create the some process. So after creating that particular process, it was going to the execution. So that's why here this particular child process will be execute. So it was ready for execute, then go for the ready queue, and then it was scheduled by the CPU. Then CPU was executing that particular process. In case completed, then terminated. In case it was waiting for some an interrupt, so and whenever interrupt was occur, and then go for the ready queue. So this is the flow. So from different queues and different resources to executing the any specific process scheduling. So this is the representation of the process scheduling. So in this representation of process scheduling, we are using the CPU execution. So that means CPU execution for executing any specific process. So for that purpose, the CPU was executing the instructions collecting from the ready queue. So this ready queue has gathered the information or gathered the processes from the different queues. So now we know what is the so already just now we was discussed. So to perform the process scheduling, so we are using some scheduler. So now we discuss about scheduler. So here to performing the process scheduling, we are using some scheduler. So it was also known as the CPU scheduler. So this scheduler is responsible for select some specific process. So that particular process should be executed by next allocation of CPU. So that means here the scheduler is the responsible for select some process. So why it was select that particular process means to schedule for execution as a next instruction by the CPU. So for that purpose we are using the scheduler. So this scheduler is responsible for to scheduling the any specific process after completion of the current process execution. So it was sometimes only scheduler in a system. So that means while we are going to performing the process scheduling at that situation, in rare cases so that particular process scheduler can have only scheduler only. So in case this short term scheduler is invoked frequently, so that means the particular scheduler is not always running on the CPU. So it was invoked frequently at some random time, either some milliseconds. So for that purpose we are using this scheduler. So now in case we are using the long term scheduler, so till now we was discussed about the short term scheduler. So it was ready for executing the next instruction, pick up next instruction which process was executed by the CPU. For that purpose we are using the short term scheduler. It was also known as the CPU scheduler. So coming to the long term scheduler, so this long term scheduler is also known as the job scheduler. So why it was used means, so this job scheduler is used to select which process should be brought into the ready queue. So which process should be brought into the ready queue. So for that purpose we are using the long term scheduler. So don't confuse. So here short term scheduler is used to giving the next instruction to the CPU for execution. Here long term scheduler is used to giving the next instruction to the ready queue. So that is the major variation among the short term scheduler and long term scheduler. So this long term scheduler is invoked frequently, seconds or minutes. So here also one more difference. Short term scheduler was frequently invoked within milliseconds and long term scheduler was invoked frequently within seconds or minutes. That means which was somewhat slower than the short term scheduler. And here the long term scheduler controls degree of the multiple programmings, multi-programming. So in this process, every process can be described or mentioned either I/O bound process or CPU bound process. So here I/O bound process means nothing but to execute any specific process, that particular process was spend more time for the I/O device. And CPU bound process means nothing but to execute some specific process, so it was spending the more time for the CPU. So this is the two kinds of bounded processes was used in the schedulers, I/O bound process and CPU bound process. So here I/O bound process may be sometimes faster and CPU bound processes may be sometimes slower. Why? Because it requires more CPU time. So here we observe addition of the some medium term scheduling. So how we are going to performing the some medium term scheduling, not for the short term and not for the long term. So here this medium term scheduler can be added if degree of multiple programs need to be decreased. So that means whenever we are going to decrease any several processes degree, so for that purpose we are using the medium scheduler. So that means this particular medium scheduler removes that particular process from the memory. So and then store on the disk. So after that, whenever we want to execute that particular process again, copied into the memory and then executing that particular process execution. So this is the process of medium term scheduler. So in previous slide we was discussed short term scheduler, long term scheduler. So in this we are discussing medium term scheduler. So in short term scheduler, so it was immediately forwarding the next instruction to the CPU. In long term scheduler, it was forwarding the next process for scheduling to the ready queue. So in medium term scheduler, it was swapping that particular process from main memory to disk memory, disk memory to main memory. So here we can observe. So in case the particular process was ready to queue, that means ready to execution, then go to the CPU for execution. So in this process, medium term scheduler, so immediately it was swap out from the main memory and stored into the secondary memory. So after that, it was swapped into the main memory. Then again, it was ready for execution. And then CPU was executing that particular process. So in this process, in case that particular process was waiting for the I/O, then again that particular request was sending to the I/O device. So in case such I/O device was respond, again go to the ready state and then executing that particular instruction or that particular process. So this is the process of medium term scheduling. So now we observe how to implement multitasking in mobile systems. So here actually multitasking means nothing but at a time it was performing the multiple process. So now consider some operating system like iOS. So here earlier versions of the iOS was allows only one process to run. So that means at a time only one process was executed and other processes should be suspended, so temporarily stops their execution. So in this process, why it was executing the only one process at a time means due to the screen real estate. So that means at a time user can able to view or can able to see on the screen only one process related information only. So that's why here iOS provides at a time only one foreground process for controlling the user interface and some number of or multiple background processes in memory. So that means whenever foreground process was completed, then any one of the background process will be come back to the foreground process to running the executing the particular process. So this is the process for iOS. In case we are considered either Android, so this Android operating system can run foreground and background processes with some limits. So at a time it can run the foreground process and background processes with some limits. So that is, so in case it was running some process as a background, so that particular process can use service to perform the several tasks. So that means whenever we are executing some specific process, so to providing the services to that currently executing process, so it was using several background process. Already was discussed in previous sessions. So whenever we are going to executing some specific process, to run the particular process smoothly, for that purpose CPU was scheduled or CPU was running some number of background processes at the same way Android also. So in this process, this service can keep running. So always it was trying to executing the particular process. Whatever the process was waiting at the background process is suspended. So that means whatever the process was suspended by the CPU, so here this service is always trying to roll back or rerunning that particular process. So here service has actually no user interface. It was having only some memory. So that means whatever the processes was running on the service, such services was not necessary and not required any user interface. So those are automatic, those are using some memory only. For example, some simple example, so you are using your mobile phone. So at currently you are running some, either currently you are making a call. So previous, before making that particular call, in case for example you are currently watching YouTube, so at that time you are receiving a call. So at that situation, what happened? Whatever the previously used process, that is watching of YouTube or watching of any video, so that is going move back to the background process. So that is suspended from the current execution and treated as the background process. And after disconnecting with that particular call, so whatever the incoming call, so that particular incoming call is currently active process. So after that is also known as the foreground process. After completion of this particular incoming call, then we are go back to the previously executed process, that is the background process, that is watching any video or anything. So here, whenever you are making the call, so making the call or receiving the call, at that time whatever the process was running on the background, so that is either watching video or playing some game, so those all are not require any user interface. Just those are required to store their information or their process information. For that purpose, it requires some memory only. So that is using some main memory, RAM memory. So that's why whenever your device, that means your mobile, was having low RAM, so you are not able to having a more number of processes on the memory. That means not able to using multiple processes at a time. So in case your device, that means mobile, was having efficient RAM memory, then you can enjoying the multitasking. So that is the reason. So next, context switch. So here, context switch means nothing but CPU can switch from one program execution or from one process execution to another process execution. So that switching is known as the context switch. So that means whenever CPU switches from one process to the another process, so that is nothing but context switch. So in this process, for example, currently CPU is running the process 0 and switch to the process 1. So at that time, so it was it must save the state of the old process. For example, currently CPU is running process 1, just assume process 1. So currently CPU is running process 1. So now process 2 was ready for execution, process 2 was ready for running. At that situation, CPU was switching from the process 1 execution to process 2 execution. So before switching from process 1 execution to process 2 execution, so at that time here CPU can save what is the status of the currently running process 1, that is old process, and load the saved state. So that current status of the old process information was saved into the some saved state. So next, it was switches to the new state or new process to execution. So in this process, context means nothing but which is the context of a process represented in the process control block. So this context switch time is overhead. Then the system does the there was no useful work while switching. So that means here this context switching process is overheaded, that means overloaded. At that situation, there was no useful work with that switching. So that means here the more complex OS and the PCB, it indicates the longer the context switch. So that means here frequently it was switching from one process execution to another process executions, means here that CPU was having the longer context switch. So in here this context switch time was majorly depending upon the hardware support. So based on the hardware support, here context switching speed or context switching number of context switches will be depended. So in this manner, some hardware provides multiple sets of registers for the CPU. That means here this context switch is depending upon the CPU. Why? Because so based on the CPU hardware, so it can provide the context switch at a time, either single context switch or multiple context switch. So to perform the any number of context switches, we need some registers. So here that is simply depending upon the number of register sets was used on the CPU. So in case that hardware provides multiple registers or multiple set of registers to the CPU, then it can performing the multiple context loaders at a time. In case so these are the details about the context switch. So now we observe operations on the process. So while we are going to performing the process execution, whatever the several operations was performed, so here while we are going to performing the operations on process. So for that purpose, we must that particular process mechanism must provide the support for process creation, process termination, and so on. So that means here that particular operating system is responsible for creating the new process and terminating the existing process and so on. So now we observe how to create the process and how to terminating the process. So coming to the first one, process creation. So here to creating the process, actually parent child is the responsible for creating the process. So for example, initially there is some process, that particular process can create the some another process. That means whatever the initial process, that process can be treated as the parent process, and it creates some additional processes, some number of sub processes. Those are the child processes or children process. So in turn create other processes. So that means one process can create the other processes. So whatever the process was creating some other process, that is the parent process. Whatever the newly created processes by the existing process, those are the children processes. So these all are represented in the form of a some tree representation. So in this, generally every process is identified with some identification or some process identifier. So that is shortly represented with PID, process ID. So here these processes was used to sharing the resources. So each and every process was having some resourcing options. So that means parent and children. So there are two processes, one is the parent and their children. So those two processes can share all resources. Parent and children can share the all resources. In case consider only child child process, so here this children share subset of parent resources. Don't confuse. So here parent child and children share, both can use all resources. Consider only children child, so it can use only some subset of processes or some set of processes provided by the parents only, parent resources only. And here parent and child commonly doesn't use any resources. That means whenever child process was starting their execution, here parent process was wait until termination of the that particular process execution. So these are the several execution options in child and parent creations, parent and child processes. So here parent and children execute concurrently. So at a time, one parent node and their children can be executed concurrently. So that means one parent node and another parent node can't able to execute simultaneously and concurrently. And here whenever children was currently executing, so at that time here parent node was must wait until children's node was termination. So this is the representation of the process creation in child node, parent node and the child node. For example, initially we are using the some process, so their ID is 1, so it can create some number of children's. So children 1, children 2, children 3. So children 1 is logging into the some device, so for that purpose creating one process. And another one is the, it was creating some thread, for that purpose it was creating some child. And another one is the some scheduling purpose, for that purpose it was using the some process. So these all are the some commands was used in the Unix environment. So that's why we don't have proper idea about the these keywords or this terminology. So here login, so this process ID is 8415. So to login into that particular process, it was creating again some sub processes. Those are the bash and ps and emacs. These are the several commands was used to login into the that particular device. So next, kthread. So in this manner, so each and every parent node was creating the some child processes. So here at a time, this init, login, kthread, sshd, so these all are executed concurrently. Why? Because this is the parent node and these are the child nodes. In case currently we are executing login, at a time it can execute login and their children processes. So in this process, here init can share all resources from the children and itself. In case coming to the kthread, it can share only the children's and their parent resources only. It can't able to use whatever the resources allocated to the SSHD. So in this manner, so these are the some terms related to the execution. So now we observe how to creating the process in Unix environment. So here while we are going to creating the process creation in Unix environment, so for that purpose we are using the fork system call or fork. So this fork fork function is used to create the some process. So here fork means it was creating the some process, and to execute that particular process by the CPU, for that purpose we are using the exec. So here exec is used to executing the any specific process. So here once it starts their execution, and after completion of their execution, it will go to the exit, that means terminating the that particular process. So to completing this entire process, creating the child process, executing the child process, and the completion of the execution of child process, to completing this entire process, here parent node was wait for the output of the children node. So whenever it was getting the output, then parent node will be executes their execution, parent process will be executed. So until that it was currently in waiting state. After getting the input resources from the child node, then it will resumes their execution. So this is the subset or address space was used by the parent node and the children node. So here fork is the system call, it was used for the creating a new process, and exe system call is used for the executing the or replacing the that particular process in memory. So this is the some sample program to creating the process in the Unix environment by using C program. So here this is the main function. So here we are creating the some process ID. So every process was having the some process identification. For that purpose we are declaring PID. So and we are creating the some new process with this process ID. So that is PID equals to fork. So it was creating some new child process. So here this process ID is the count is rank is less than 0. So that means currently there was no processes was created. So that's why it will display this some error. So in case that the process ID is value is ranking is equals to 0. So that means it was not having any children processes itself having some process. So this ranking is nothing but so here init. So this is this ranking is 0. So their level is 0. So login their level is 1. Bash their level is 2. PS their level is 3. So it was checking their ranking at their level. So that's why whenever their process ID level is 0, that means it was not having any child process. So only parent process only. So in case their level is more than 0, then it was having the some children processes. So in this way, so that's why whenever their rank is not equals to less than 0 and equal to 0 means it may be 1, 2, 3 and so on. At that situation, it will wait for the child process execution. So after completion of the child process execution, it will go back to the parent process execution. So this is the some simple program to creating the process in C programming environment. So these are the details about process scheduling and just for creation of the process. So in next session, we can discuss remaining two things. So how to process will be terminated and how process will be resumed. So those two things will be discussed in the next session. So thank you.